Hello everyone, welcome to EduTalks. Today we have Dr. Bhattacharya with us, a leading educationist in NCR. She's currently the principal of Manav Rachna International School and is the ex-principal of GD Goenka. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for agreeing to be on our show. At EduTalks, we try to get leading educationists like yourself so that other parents and teachers, they can gain from your journey and improve their parenting and teaching. Thank you once again, ma'am, for being on our show. So, ma'am, it would be great if you could just take us through your journey so that our parents and teachers would know more about you.
Thank you so much, Aditya. It has been really, since the time we've been talking about this particular program, I was also very excited because it's always nice to reach out to number of students and parents. And I am telling you, your organization like yours is doing a great job, reaching out to, with such topics, which is so important for students and parents. To talk about myself, I belong to the Army fraternity and all through being to different parts of the country, teaching at all levels. And I think I've gained such confidence because of this 21 years in this education journey has been really a fulfilling one. At present, this is my 11th year as a leader, and I'm the principal of Manav Rachna International School, Chambord. To talk about my journey, as I said, it's been very, very fruitful, and I love being with students, especially teenage has always been a very attractive portion of my spending my time with. You know, I see the zeal in the students, in the adolescents, the problems that they have, and it's always so fulfilling and so satisfying when you talk to these teenagers and you get to know about them. It keeps me always very young at heart, and of course we get to know so much from them. Another attraction that I always felt in this journey was the tiny tots, the little ones. They are so innocent, they are just flowers, and you go to them, you talk to them, your day is made. Visiting all the states that I have been, the best part was when I worked in the border areas where I had children whose parents were fighting at the borders, and how we teachers used to be taking care of not only the children, but also the parental part, how they should guide the students, and in that mental trauma, the mental stress, the way the children were doing in academics, I think that's a very satisfying tenure I have. However, even now I'm enjoying my bit absolutely in a very wonderful manner. I love my profession. That's what I can say.
That's great, ma'am. And ma'am, like any particular role model or someone you admire, like someone who influenced your journey?
In my long journey, there are many, but I would like to mention Dr. Abdul Kalam. I have attended a number of sessions face-to-face with him, and he's always been such an inspiration that a person from such an area coming up to such height and influencing so many citizens of the country. He's always been such a role model for me, and I love reading his books. I love listening to him. He's a great personality, I feel.
And I'm like we all have seen principles like when we grew up, and all of us have a particular idea that this is what a principal would be doing. But I always know that reality at times is very different. We see only a very small part, I gather, of what a leader does on a day in, day out basis. So could you just share, ma'am, like apart from teaching, so what are the things that a leader has to take care of in a school and keep it in mind?
You know, the role of a principal is always, generally it's known that they are supposed to be very serious, just saying no to everyone. It is not exactly like this. And I strongly believe that I need to take the team with me. I am a true leader when I can create leaders. That's how my work, I base my work on. So taking the team with positivity is something that is a true leader's work. So say, for example, if you talk of this pandemic, last 20 2020 March, when we had to shift the paradigm shift of the teachers from the campus role to the virtual mode, was not easy. You know, it was a tough job, and wherever I get this opportunity, I keep mentioning that teachers have done an excellent job.
Absolutely.
And taking care of the mental health of so many students was not easy. Not only that, parents were also losing their job, losing their dear ones, and children seeing that. There was a stress at every level, even at the teacher's home front. So taking the team with positivity, giving them that assurance, it's okay, not only to the students, but also to the team of my colleagues, taking them with them that, yes, it's okay, you have a role to play, you're the captain of the ship, and therefore you need to be positive and take it as a strength that, yes, I am the captain and I have to lead my team. So that's what I think is the main job of the principal. Leaving aside, in a normal scenario, most of the principals, the successful principal, they hardly sit in their office during the school time. No? They're roaming around, meeting the students, talking to them. And as I mentioned, we have immense potential in the youth of today. You know, the moment, because adolescence is a revolting stage. So do not concentrate on that revolting attitude. Instead, if we find out why the child is revolting, if we try to find out and be beside the child, give him the space for his creativity, I think we can play a wonderful role in transforming a revolting child to a very creative child. And that's how, as a principal, I have been doing my work, even while being a teacher. I love being always, I've mostly taught senior classes. So got so much of love from the students, love from the team. I think this is one of the key role which helped me to move ahead. And I am so happy that I've always got such positive response. I'm grateful to the Almighty. And I hope I can carry out whatever bit little I can give to give that positivity to my team and, of course, to my students.
Sure, ma'am. You mentioned a point about mental health. And could you share a few examples of what you did in particular, or like what other teachers can learn from? Because like handling mental health is a threefold task for a leader like you. First, you have to ensure that your own mental health, in amidst all this stress and mayhem, you have to keep your calm. And then teachers, because ultimately, if your teachers, like your team, if they are not at the top of your game, ultimately it will be very difficult for them to transfer, because all of them were in families where different, very difficult times were on, and they were handling that also at the same time, ensuring that the children's learning did not suffer, and the parents, because it was a very tough thing that I gather you manage, and you're still balancing that act right now. So any particular things, ma'am, like do's and don'ts, or some particular activities which you felt helped a lot in this area, ma'am?
You were right. Time has not been very easy, especially if I talk of the second wave. It was really traumatic. Losing every day, you could get the news of losing someone or the other, maybe friends, maybe colleagues, maybe my students' parents. And we've lost so many young parents, and it was really very tough. So there was no formula as such. It came automatically. My organization ensured that whatever assistance we had, a committee, whatever assistance required, be it the oxygen cylinder, be it doctor's name, or be it the hospital beds, wherever possible, the organization helped. So similarly, belonging to this organization, we ensured that everyone giving a call to at least group of parents, it was not possible to talk to everyone every day. However, giving that assurance, a small message that, yes, I am there, the organization is there with you, that gave too much of positivity. Not only that, we had groups where teachers were segmented, where they would connect with the parents. A child, we were collecting the data if any parent is suffering from COVID. So in fact, visiting was not possible, but on a virtual mode, talking to them, talking to the students, leave aside giving the informations and even oxygen cylinders, giving beds. We had vaccination camp in the school so that everyone is vaccinated. These small things we went on doing so that everyone felt like a family. To talk of my colleagues in on a smaller circle, if I would say, yes, definitely, they had a tough time. There were many who have lost their in-laws, they've lost their elderly parents who have had been, in fact, at one time I had 32 teachers who were COVID positive in the second wave. So it was not an easy task, you know, giving that assurance, because that particular time everyone was stressed that it's my number today. What will happen to me? Well, there was one colleague of mine there whose husband was hospitalized for a long duration. So talking to them, giving them that assurance, sending food if required through different modes, that was something which we did, and we were connected. That was something which made us go and keep going. The connectivity we have ensured that though we are at indoors, we were connected to each other, so that we got that assurance that I'm not alone. That's something which we did. You see, to talk of activities, we involved parents in lots of activities. There were fitness programs that were done. There were happy hour program that we have done. Wherever there was no compulsion, but then yes, we tried to reach out to the parents, because even they were stressed. They were stressed because they are working, because there are people who were not well, and at the same time, class 10 and 12, both children, they were not knowing what is there in front. So there was total stress amongst everywhere. So we were connected. And lots of programs we did with the parents. We've involved them in cookeries, in physical activities, in Zumba dance. All these small things we did depending on the age group of the parents. And we were all connected. That's all that I have
to say. And ma'am, like I gathered, definitely this was have been very trying times, and finding time for yourself, keeping yourself sane. So what was your secret sauce, so to say, which helped you stay motivated and calm at the same time?
I would love to mention that, because that's something what I keep telling my colleagues. Whatever you do, whatever busy schedule you have to have some time for yourself. Because unless and until you are mentally fit, you cannot, if you are not happy, you cannot create a happy atmosphere. So that's right. Something what I myself observe very, very minutely, that I start my day with a yoga. Yoga is a must that I do every day, and I keep telling my colleagues that whatever gives you that pleasure, that happiness, start your day with it, so that you can start a new day with new hopes, with new dreams, and of course with new positivity. So starting a day with a glass of water on an empty stomach and then going in for yoga is actually the key to my positivity, I would say.
Great ma'am. And I'm like not all days would be like, in spite, I understand you try to have a fresh start every day, you follow this routine of yoga, and you, because you have to be very positive throughout the day, but there would be, I guess there must have been some difficult situations which would have come, and could you share any such, ma'am, episode where you faced a difficult situation and how you sort of overcame that, and maybe a few learnings from that?
Yeah, definitely. Every day is not same. In fact, as I was sharing, that colleagues' family is not keeping well. Oblique, small students, a child of class 5 lost the father. I mean, such news was really disturbing. And of course, our organization tried to help them in every possible way. Even now, we are helping them out with full scholarship. And we have a NGO where we put those children's name and they are studying. They have given the consent of continuing their education without any fees. So these are few things. But yes, if you ask me about a particular incident, yeah, the second wave did take away one of my very close person. That was such a sad news. He was just 52, and he was one of my directors of GD Goenka Public School. So close to me. However, we have to understand that yes, God has his plans. Life has to carry on. The deepest wound also gets is healed due to time. So I suppose, yeah, every day is not same, but we have to have that positivity in us, stating that it's a journey. Life can't be only with smiles, and they like water and land. Similarly, we have happiness and sorrow. So we can't brood on what has happened. Try to do our best to keep our cool and start a new day with new hopes.
Right. Ma'am, recently we came across a lot of things, like COVID has changed many things, and few things we have seen this huge utilization of online resources and this technology. And Ma'am, how much do you think this impact of technology on education would remain, like after things normalize? Like, is it there to stay, or how will it shape
up? Now that we have started, like you must be aware, the NEP 2020 and COVID together, as if came together, were meant for clashing with each other. But whatever, right, the best thing that could have happened during this pandemic, with all the ill effects of pandemic and COVID, I think the best thing that could have happened is the usage of technology, which is the need of the hour. You know, our parents would come to us complaining that the child is always with gadgets. How do we take it away from them? So I would, not only because of pandemic, I would give that message that taking them away from technology will be a crime. They are born with it, you know. Mm-hmm. We give them much before they can learn to talk or walk. So you can't take it away. Only thing is, we need to guide them for proper usage. Now that we have digitized our education system, even if we open, I think this will not go. There's going to be a blended education system that we have, we will start with. And I suppose this has happened for good. You know, we admire what's happening in the outside countries, the advanced countries, as we say, that children or parents are getting to know all that's happening to a child in school, on the tab, while the mother is working also. So this is exactly what we have taken up now. You know, this should continue now that we have all usage of technology. We should keep using it, but yes, it should be a blend, because ultimately at the end of the day, the body language, when the children come in the campus, the smile, the eye contact, these are something which children are missing. The games part they are missing. So we need to combine both, because children are doing so much of research while the technologies started being used. You know, they are editing, they are creating their portfolios, beautiful. I mean, there's so much to learn. So why go away again from this? It should be a blended approach now, even when things get normal. So it's going to be a new normal everywhere, and of course, definitely in the education sector.
You mentioned a very important point here, that students have learned a lot of skills.
Yeah.
They are researching, they are going online, and they're acquiring a lot of knowledge on their own. Yes. So if I were a teacher, suddenly my job is very difficult, because I cannot be on a pedestal. Mm-hmm. And that information gap is going away very fast, because students have access to that same information on the internet. They are going and Googling. So if I were a teacher, how would I prepare myself for this change that has, like, it was happening earlier also, but its speed has changed suddenly. So as a teacher, suppose, how would I prepare for this?
Yeah, that's a very, very, very valid question. First, once again, I will say that their teachers in this March 2020 and April 2020 was the toughest time of their life, because they had to totally shift on this virtual mode. Right. So there was rigorous practice, rigorous workshops, everything was taken to upgrade themselves. It's not that teachers did not know, but yeah, definitely, you know, we were a little apprehensive of using technology.
Right.
This pandemic has given us that push. And I would now here say that teachers need to upgrade themselves with the 21st century skills, which is, one of them is digitization. If you have not done it this 1 year, I don't think you are going to survive in this profession. Why this profession? Any profession, I would say. So teachers did upgrade, but the wonderful thing was, you know, there was a dual learning. Children were teaching in the initial days. Ki, ma'am, go to your right side. There's a button. Click on that. Then you can
share. Absolutely.
It was a beautiful learning. Children teaching students, teachers, and teachers giving them the lessons. That was, in fact, I wouldn't mind saying it, that I've learned so much from my child.
Right, ma'am.
To make these presentations more attractive. So yes, with technology, we will not be at par with our students, definitely. But then the lessons, you have to have a depth in your knowledge. You have to have a depth as a 21st century skills that is required. You need to know that and be beside the students. They don't want you to be expert on technology and teach them, because they know much more than you. Technology, they are much ahead of us. So utilizing their knowledge and delivering or being beside them as a facilitator, these days it's not a lecture method anymore. So you're learning and teaching together. So that's a beautiful thing that has happened. And I feel it's going to progress, and we are going to do good, definitely.
Sure, ma'am. You touched upon the 21st century skills.
Yes.
And I gather that as any student, the 21st century skills is going to bring a lot of challenges and opportunities. That's why we hear a lot of first generation billionaires coming up. It's not just that earlier a businessman's son will start a business. Now you have a lot of entrepreneurs coming. These are first generation entrepreneurs. Yeah. They're starting their own stuff. And we have a lot of first generation people who are going to English medium schools. And they're also availing different professions. They're becoming IT professionals and they're becoming doctors, lawyers. So there's a lot of exposure out there. But at the same time, there's a lot of risk of obsolescence. So earlier education was very subject oriented, expertise of subjects. And with the increasing threat or opportunity as we see it, artificial intelligence, machine learning, increased digitization, what we are studying right now might not be like subject expertise might not be relevant a decade or two down the line. So as a teacher, how do we ensure that our children are developing the correct skills, like skills like problem solving skills, critical thinking, creativity, imagination? So what should a teacher sort of keep in mind that the students are developing the correct set of skills?
Yes, if I talk of 21st century skills, you have already mentioned the socio-emotional needs is something which is very, very much needed. You know, many a times we have seen that our Indian students are very good when it comes to academics, when it comes to curriculum, but when they are going for going outside and trying to, I mean, they could have done beautifully well, but they are a failure because we have not taught them in school how to be a team leader, how to work in a team, how to take care of the empathy, how to understand others. These are some things which you cannot go without as of now, because everyone knows. Now, just because you are a 90% or 95%, great in your work, that is no more there, you know. True. You have to have these skills, and that is what 21st century skills we can mention. So in the classroom, we have to create such scenario where a child is given the chance to be more creative. The child is given a chance to question rather than just giving the stereotyped answer. So this is something which all teachers now are working. The teacher's job initially used to be, I've done my BEd, I've done my post-graduation, so I'm a perfect teacher. Now it is not so. She or he has to upgrade in the lesson, in the advancement that's going on in his subject. If I have learned chemistry, oblique maths a few years back, I have to keep myself updated. This is what we, as I, in fact, as a leader, and of course, everywhere we are trying to put it, and the teachers are working, that first I have to have a current knowledge of my subject. And while I am there with my children, I am no more a lecturer. I'm just going to be beside them, giving them the opportunity to question me on my subject, so that I can come out with those answers. Another thing is communication skill. 21st century, as I said, we were connected, which I meant is that communication was there. So communication skill is something very, very important. We need to teach our children. We need to teach our children to be understanding and, of course, respect their elders, and try to be a good citizen of the country. And these are the skills that we need to teach, because we can't prepare them anymore for a job which we used to do. Medical hai, doctor banna hai, engineer banna hai, or chartered account banna hai. Aajkal there are innumerable number of opportunities. Children who were not very good in academics in school, doing excellently well, and good leaders, as you have pointed out, doing so well. Nothing depends. These days, everything is so exposed. If you are doing well, you are just picked up by any company, by any field. So these few skills that we need to teach, it is that we have to give them the assurance that you have your capabilities. But then you have to be sincere with your work. There is no shortcut to success.
Right, ma'am. Like, I have a 5-year-old kid, Virat, and definitely he's a lot more privileged than I was when I grew up.
Yes.
So as a parent, how do I balance this? Like, and where do I draw that line? Is there a mantra to it that we don't overdo it?
This is very important. You know, aajkal most of the parents have got one child and they get everything that is available. We want to make them, all parents dream that the child has to be good in sports, good in swimming, good in studies, good in everything. That's what every parent dreams of, you know. Right. And that is the reason why we try to put them in different coaching classes, put them in different academies. Of course, now because of the pandemic, that's closed. But we give them the exposure to everything possible. You buy a Kindle for them and they are reading. While doing so, we must not forget that we need to teach our children the discipline. You know, you can't tell them no, no, no for everything, but give them that much freedom and give them the limitations. That limitation, that line has to be drawn that you cannot go beyond. You use technology, fine. You go in for education, you are using it for your research, you are using it for everything. But you have to understand that limitation needs to be set. From this time to this time is your hour. You have to understand that they need to learn that they have to have meals with their parents if required. They have to understand that their sleeping time, their lunch time and their dinner time should be a little fixed. Now, again, there you might have revolting attitude towards the children, especially teenage. They might say, why so? Who said lunchtime is 1:30? Why not lunchtime at 3:30? So depending on the, because this is very common.
Right.
Said good or bad is depending on me. What is good, what is bad. For you, going to sleep at 11 o'clock is fine. For me, 1:30 is fine. So these are the things. Then we need to listen to them, explain to them why is it that they want it. And of course, be a little flexible. Don't be rigid. Because if the moment you're rigid, there is more opposition. So be flexible. Depending on a five-year-old kid, you are still lucky that the child is five-year-old. He will still listen to you. Gradually, when you see the child coming into teens, there's a revolting attitude. So it's no point going against them. But yes, go with them with certain limitation. You adjust a little, they will definitely adjust to you.
Right.
That is what is the mantra, I feel.
Okay. Ma'am, one more thing I need your feedback on. When I speak to a lot of educationists and a lot of people at very senior level at the industry also, a common theme comes out that academics is okay, but apart from that, you need to focus that children develop a rounded personality and they have exposure to multiple things. But so my two cents on that has always been that, like my peer group and friends, myself, we were very good at academics. Because of that, we went to the best of colleges. We got into the top B schools of the country. And at each point of the junction, like every junction, we met amazing people and we learned together because of that exposure and we grew together. Now, had it not been for academics, I might not have been privileged to be in one of the top B schools of the country or a top college of the country. So is it very just a cliche like thing to say that, okay, studies is not very important, you need to focus on other things? Or like how does this work? And as a parent, what should I focus on? Like I don't want to end up giving him too much exposure. Ultimately, he doesn't crack an IIM or he doesn't crack one of the, let's say, the top 20 B schools. And because there's a huge difference in the salary ranges also, what a person starts off. Someone starts at a 10 lakh rupees and someone starts at a 30 lakh rupees. You are 10 years behind. So how do we strike that balance, or how does this work?
There are many IITians I have seen, I've interacted with, coming out from such great colleges with such huge package. Then they change their stream. I am very close to a person who is an IITian, had excellent job in Dubai, came back and started doing something which is just not his area. So what do we expect? We want our children to be happy, right? So that happiness, yes, if I talk as a parent, if I talk as a teacher, happiness is coming out with 90 plus marks, getting a good college, doing a good job, and then of course having a family, and that's it. The ideology is. However, we have to tell them that marks is important because that's a green card to some extent. So if you have that number with you, I think you have an access to many things. That's what we need to make them understand. However, if everyone gets 19, if everyone goes to the best of colleges, then what about the others? we need to tell them that if you have to get good marks, if you want a good college, if you want good friends, as you mentioned, good teachers, definitely a good college is what you need. However, your mental satisfaction. So it's not only academics that will carry you. There are, as we have, we started our discussion with this, there are so many professions these days. Gone are those days where only getting into IIT and clearing your JEE will give you a good college. No. You need to go in for many work. You need to plan your day. First, you need to teach our children what's your dream. Try to, as a parent, as a young parent, I need to find out my child's interest. What is the child interested in? And give an exposure to not so many, but restrict the exposure to his likings. Just because as a parent, I wanted to be a doctor, giving him a medical kit as a play toy is not what I need to do. I need to see his interest at a young age and give an exposure to it, guide him throughout, beside explaining to him that yes, doing every day's curriculum is important. However, this is not the only thing.
Absolutely.
Discipline in life and having a dream, consistent work, be sincerity will definitely bring in success. If not in academics, maybe in cartoon making, oblique, maybe in any field, you know, we can excel in any field, I can say.
I'm like, you beautifully, I would say, in a way, summarized, like, by what you mentioned, that as a parent, identify the interests of your child, understand what the dreams are, sort of then you gauge, limit the exposure that you want to provide to your child, so that is, you don't sort of overwork him also in like trying to ensure that he becomes a hero at everything. So, and then ensure the child is disciplined, sincere, backs it up with real hard work, whatever stream he is looking at, could be academics, could be something different, but ultimately if you're not sincere, you're not working hard, you will not excel at anything. And academics is definitely not the only green card, so to say, using your parlance. It's one of them, definitely very important.
Yeah.
But if we can find the right interest and the right passion and the right direction and sincerity, back it up with very hard work, there's definitely a lot that can happen. And your points about 21st century skills, where both teachers and parents have to be aware that equipped with 21st century skills, because ultimately that is what is going to translate into the lives of the children. So if I'm a teacher, I'll have to have basic appreciation of technology, and COVID sort of thrusted that upon the teachers. And now hopefully that this new blended approach that you mentioned that will come forth, and it will definitely help in getting all these things together. And communication, without communication is what ensured that the last 18 months or so, more than that, as a team, both parents, teachers, we lived through it and did justice to the learning of a child. And that communication is the same thing, the same force which will ensure that we do better in future also. So a few things that I picked up, ma'am, from the discussion. And thanks a lot, ma'am. Thanks a lot for the session and sparing your time from your hectic schedule. And our parents and teachers will definitely appreciate what you shared. And we will definitely stay in touch, ma'am, and look forward to having more sessions from you in the future.
Thank you so much for having me in this platform. One thing I would want to conclude with, sure, is have faith in our children. As parents, as teachers, we need to give them this, that we love them. And whatever they do, if it's right, we appreciate them, you know, rather than putting in certain rules and regulation, let us try to learn and appreciate and giving them the opportunity. Our youth has got immense potential. We need to be beside them. That's it, I would want to say. And with a positive thought, always you yourself need to be happy. If you are happy, you will create happiness in your environment. That's it. Otherwise, thank you so much for bringing me here. I really appreciate your endeavor once again to reach out to so many parents. And thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Jai Hind, and have a healthy and safe journey always. Thank you.
Sure. Thanks a lot.